Morning and welcome to the 19th meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2024. We have apologies this morning from Stephanie Callaghan, and our Vice Convener Ruth McGuire is joining us online. Our first agenda item this morning is the consideration of the following subordinate legislation: the Teachers' Pension Scheme Scotland Amendment Regulations 2024, SSI 2024/147. And these regulations are being considered under the negative procedure. So I was wondering if any members have any issues that they'd like to raise about this. Can I come to yourself first, please, Pam? Duncan Glancy.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Last week we had UCU given evidence, and one of the things that they noted was that the UK government is paying the cost of the increased employer contributions in the teacher pension scheme in England at 5%, and that additional monies is likely as a result to come to the Scottish Government through the Barnett consequentials. The equivalent increase in employers' costs in Scotland, I understand, is around 3%. So would it be possible for the committee to ask the Scottish Government to confirm whether it intends to pass the consequentials to the SFC for the scheme, and whether it will do this at 3% or 5%?
Okay, thank you, Pam. Anyone else? I've got Liam Kerr first, please, and then Mr. McPherson.
It's not an unrelated point, actually, that if the Barnett consequentials come up, to be then distributed to employers of teachers in order to meet the increased contributions, then that begs a question about whether the Scottish Government is required to use the increased Barnett funding in that way, or whether they're not mandated to do so. Okay. And in the current context of councils in particular not having the greatest of means, let's put it that way, I think that's a question that I would like to understand the answer to.
Okay, I've got Ben McPherson, who's indicated as well.
Thank you, Convener. Just in order to help with the understanding that we're seeking, that colleagues have raised, I think we should also be asking the Government if the consequentials have indeed been passed to the Scottish Government, and in what fashion they have been, whether they were in year or for one financial year or in a longer process. I just think we need to have a full understanding of the situation.
Thank you. Does anyone else want to? Michelle Thompson.
Just a brief top-up on that. I think it's a fair comment from my colleague Ben McPherson in terms of the process of allocation, and it may well be worthwhile that we explore further. Although that said, I'd be very surprised that if the Scottish Government were mandated to pull that through in exact same format, then that's exactly what they would do, because that's a legal requirement. But it may well be that there's a misunderstanding, given this is the Education Committee, of the flow through of the financials and the process and the point at which money arrives in the Scottish Government. I think that may be worthwhile to explore.
I think given the understanding and the confirmation that we're all seeking, I think it would be wise of us to write to the Scottish Government to address the points that our members have made this morning, if that's okay. And in terms of the timelines, we can discuss that later on as to deadlines and when we can discuss the response before we proceed with that SSI. Are we all content with that approach? Right, that's super. Are the clerks content with that? Good, I'm just checking. They've got everything down that they need to. Okay, thank you. Our second item this morning is an evidence session on pre-budget scrutiny. And we are focusing on the financial sustainability of the university and colleges sector. Can I welcome our... Hold on.
Sorry, there's a technical issue.
Okay. So, in the room today, we have Seana Struthers, Chief Executive of Colleges Scotland, Gareth Williams, Head of Policy from Prosper, and Professor Ian Gillespie, Convener of University Scotland. We are hoping to get online very shortly Professor John McKendrick, the Commissioner for Fair Access, but we're having a number of technical issues, but we shall proceed nonetheless and move directly to members' questions. And can I come in first with Willie Rennie, please? Thank you.
Good morning. We've heard quite considerable evidence about the financial outlook for further and higher education institutions, colleges and universities. And I would just like to hear directly from you both, Seana and Ian, initially about what that looks like and how you're coping. Shona, do you want to kick off?
Yeah, good morning and thank you very much for the opportunity to speak to you this morning. So the college sector right now, I would say I have never quite seen it in the way that it is. We have many, many of our institutions who are forecasting a deficit position. Cash reserves are definitely on the decline. There some colleges are talking about having no cash of their own by July. That's not to say that someone can come in and help them. But I think for me, that when I look at the college sector just now, it's such an important sector to deliver on Scottish Government priorities. It slightly beggars belief that it's not invested in to the point where you know, students deserve to get a good education at college and the staff deserve to work in good working environments. But right now, we see many of our students, they're not sure if, you know, they're going to get their qualifications because of industrial relations as well. So it is a bit of a perfect storm in terms of the college sector, in terms of funding, industrial relations. And I think it's such a pity because actually in society, part of the role of College of Scotland is to promote the benefits of a college education, and that still exists. So I would just like to see a restoration of our funding, and I would like colleges to be promoted more, not just in Parliament. We know that the Cabinet Secretaries are going around colleges now, a commitment from the previous First Minister, but just out in society, the benefit of college education, and that's alongside university education. It's not a zero-sums game. It's not instead of, it's alongside it, because actually Scotland will benefit from a good college education system for individuals and for the economy, for businesses.
So before I come to Professor Gillespie, what's the real-life consequences for students and staff of this situation?
Well, for students first, it's very obvious. A lot of our students, when they come to college, this is their first opportunity to gain qualifications and confidence and skills and then go on to either further ed or higher education or to get a job. So if that doesn't happen, the consequences are very, very serious and significant. And it can also affect full families as well. So it's taking people out of poverty, it's making them contribute economically, and it's also giving them an education. And then, of course, the opportunity cost of not going to college is the potential impact on other services such as social security, the health service, the justice service, and so on.
And my point is that happening right now? Are people losing out right now because of this?
Well, I'm hoping that a lot of people who want to go to college can get into college. It's a difficult one for us to measure whether people can't get into college. But I want to see colleges grow.
Yeah.
I don't want them to be in a declining position that they're currently in. I want to see colleges grow because the more that we develop individuals in our society and give them a college education, everyone benefits.
Professor Gillespie.
So I've seen, thank you for that. Well, there's an old adage around universities in the UK which says home students break even, except in Scotland. Research loses money and international students' income makes up the gap. And that's been the case for quite some time. Our model, our funding model, is predicated on that. And recently, in the last year, we've seen some movements around that. So Scottish students cost money. We need to subsidise Scottish students through the funding model. That's become a more acute issue in the past year with an actual nominal budget cut as well as a real terms decline in funding for student education. Research doesn't get any cheaper, and our funding for research is falling behind quite significantly our English neighbours, which makes us increasingly less competitive for research. And most urgently for us, the international student market has declined very significantly indeed. And it's an average decline of 20-something percent, depending how you measure it. But for some institutions, that declines as much as 75%. So that's had a huge, huge, huge impact on the income to Scottish universities, almost all of our Scottish universities. Not everyone recruits internationally. That's put really significant pressures on maintaining high-quality education, strong research, driving the economy and making place, which is what universities are about. Somehow we need to change that outlook for ourselves moving forward. The question about how we're coping right now, well, our universities in Scotland, I'm delighted to say, are actually quite well run. Part of the reason for that is we've somewhat had to be with a rather squeezed funding model for a number of years. That's just an observation. And so vice-chancellors, staff, students, the community, all the teams involved are doubling down on efforts to ensure that provision continues to be strong, quality is strong, outputs are strong. And although you will have heard from the press and from conversations that I'm sure all members will have had with individuals in your constituencies, that there are some really significant local pressures, as a sector, we feel that we can maintain quality of provision and scope of provision in the very short term. The huge challenge for us is what happens in the beyond the short term. Beyond the short term, I mean more than a year out from now. And looking to what that future looks like for us, how long can we continue to be resilient and ensure a quality education for students, ensure the welfare of students. We need more, and we have less to give that. That's a challenge for us right now.
So something interesting you said there about the sector as a whole, you have confidence in that the provisional continue to be provided, but individual institutions, there was local reports about those. I know you won't want to go into huge details about some of those issues, but are you indicating that some of those institutions may not survive?
I'm not indicating. For the avoidance of doubt, I don't see at the moment that there is a risk of survival. What there is a risk of is a change in the shape of provision. So the institutions all must take mitigating measures now to deal with the financial consequences that are coming at us. If I give a simple example, because I can do it collectively, you've just talked about the STPS. Well, if there isn't an uplift in support for employers' contribution to the STPS, that on top of the Scottish Funding Council's necessity to remove, as part of their allocations, the support for the pension scheme. That's a £9.2 million hole in support for Scottish teachers' pension schemes for the post-92 universities. That's entirely unexpected. RAC, entirely unexpected. My own university, it's a bill of more than £35 million. On top of all of these other things, what we will see is our institutions, what we are seeing, is our institutions taking mitigating actions to continue to be able to function. We are, as I say, well-run institutions. So I personally, and time will be my witness in this, I personally don't see that there is a risk to the viability of universities going forward, but there is a clear and present and future increasing risk to the quality and the scope of provision.
Bring in Michelle Thompson on this thread, if that's okay. Thank you.
Yeah, good morning. Thank you for joining us. I hear what you're saying very clearly, Professor Gillespie. So the probability of that risk occurring, i.e. an institution failing due to cash flow shortages or some other financial issue, you would assess it low? I'm just putting that in the record. Is that correct, my understanding?
Well, I can't speak for individual institutions, and I think to have that discussion for the record and be very clear on that, one would need a discussion with each of the individual principals.
How can you be clear in your earlier statement to Willie Rennie, where you said that you didn't think that was likely? Sorry, I forget the exact words you used, so please.
So my opinion.
Okay.
My opinion is that institutions will adapt. Will take mitigating measures that will adapt to the current financial situation. that will not be cost-free, that will have impacts on the provision of education to Scottish and non-Scottish domiciled students. It will have impact on the scope of our provision. It will have impact on let me say it, jobs. It will have impact on the ability of universities to continue to drive the economies which they sit in the core of. Mm-hmm. But my expectation, and it is that, it's an opinion, okay. Be clear. My expectation is that universities will find ways one way or another of adapting to the headwinds, yeah. But there will be a cost.
And that's exactly what I would expect to happen. The reason I may appear slightly startled about that is that there have been dire warnings from elsewhere in the UK, particularly from former, like, for example, UK government ministers that are proclaiming, in their opinion, that they think it's likely that some institutions may fail in England, which obviously begs the question, well, presumably they are taking the same mitigation steps as any other institution, and therefore, what is different, in your opinion, with what's happening elsewhere in the UK, where it's considered a higher probability than is happening in Scotland? I'm just not clear about that.
So our funding model is different. And
yeah,
our gearing ratio, our average gearing ratio is different. Where Scottish universities' gearing ratio, so that the debt to income is a bit less than 30%. Whereas we have institutions south of the border who have very substantially higher gearing ratios than that. So they are servicing debt. So their immediate problem is a cash flow problem, a liquidity problem. I'm not suggesting that there is no liquidity challenge in Scottish universities, because a number of our universities do have debt that they must service. Some don't,
yeah,
but a number do. And they will take measures to reduce their fixed costs in order to free up cash to service that debt. Some English institutions, and this you'll appreciate, I'm not going to get into the detail of individual ones, some English institutions have grown much more rapidly and have exposed themselves to higher gearing ratios. It is my opinion, but let me be clear, although I'm a university principal, I'm a microbiologist by background, it is my opinion that Scottish universities are in a situation that they will be able to adapt. But I want to emphasise, it will not be without implications for the education of Scottish students. Mm-hmm.
I think the point you make about gearing and lending to English universities is very well made, and I understand that clearly. And there's part of the risk there for them if they've taken on lending against fixed assets on a commercial basis, that the lending institutions could pull in loans, as we've seen in other types of areas. I take it that's what you're alluding to, as well as the cash flow issue, where's cash out day kind of idea.
Well, most of them have taken out long-term bonds.
Yeah, okay.
And they've taken out long-term bonds when interest rates were historically low. But nevertheless, they have banking covenants that restrict their free operating cash, and they must address these banking covenants. Many of them have grown very substantially, partly because of their ability to recruit larger numbers of UK students through the fee model, and partly because of a push to international recruitment. They're coming under pressures, and it will be for each of them individually to work with their bankers on how they may, for example, reschedule the debts.
Yeah. Okay, I don't want to, but you make a very, very fundamental point about gearing that I don't think has been understood in this legislature fundamentally from a financial perspective, so thanks for that. Just to follow on and finish off this kind of thread, in terms of the process and monitoring, and perhaps you'd be able to come in here, Shona, in terms of that regular monitoring, be it the SFC or indeed the Scottish Government, if there was something that needed to be highlighted, can you just talk us through the process in terms of any risk assessment of financial viability? Can I assume that that's happening on an ongoing basis? Because after all, it's businesses you're running and you're applying the usual measures. Am I correct in that? And if I'm not, put me right.
My understanding from colleges is obviously they have boards of management and they are responsible for running colleges. They would have risk registers, they would be reviewing their finances, absolutely. And then, of course, there is that relationship with the funding council, that College of Scotland is not always party to that relationship. Okay. But that relationship between funding council and a college, especially if there's financial challenges, that's something that the colleges work with. And I think one difference from the university sector, colleges are in the public sector. So very different set of rules around what colleges can and can't do. So, of course, we would look to the funding council and to government to assist. And similar to the university story there is that colleges will keep adapting and adapting and adapting and bringing their costs down and reducing staffing and reducing curriculum because they can't. They can't not balance their books because they're in the public sector. Yep. But that doesn't mean to say there's not consequences to that.
Exactly. I think the financial element we put across very clearly. Thank you, Convener.
That's great. Do you want to come back, Mr. Rennie?
So I'll maybe come back later.
Okay. Do you want
me to go on to my next bit? Or?
Yeah, number four.
Yeah, okay. That's fine. Yeah. We've talked a lot about finances here, but in terms of, and I hear your warnings about the provision in the light of that, and that's understood. In terms of support for both your sectors from both the Scottish Government and the Funding Council, what additional support would you ideally like to have at this point in time? I know everybody will say, well, yeah, we want more money. So imagine that that's not the case, given the prevailing fiscal climate, what additional support would you ideally like to see?
Well, I can see I've got the red light on, perhaps I'll go first.
I need you to go first, yeah.
Exactly. Well, clearly, the budgets available to governments are very restricted at the moment. So let me be as realistic and as moderate as I can be. I think The key message in the very short term is about flexibility and predictability. And at the moment, if I pick up on predictability, first of all, you will obviously all have seen that a number of so-called SQE places were taken out of funding in this most recent settlement. I have to say that we have a record number of Scottish domiciled students in Scottish universities this year, higher than ever before, despite that removal of what was a temporary measure. Nevertheless, if there is other assortment of allocations of where student numbers are placed, then what we would like to be able to do, and our colleagues in Scottish Funding Council are very aware of this and we're in conversation with them, is have more predictability about where that's going to come so that we can build that into our recruitment cycles. And that predictability around recruitment cycles is incredibly important given that students are thinking now about applying for next year. Second thing is flexibility. So as places, however they have been funded, are taken out of the system, our biggest challenge is the amount of resource that we as institutions have per funded place, because that's what's going down at the moment. So taking numbers out, but keeping the resources in the system so that we can increase the unit of resource would be our fundamental number one ask. Mm-hmm. And then there are some elements of the system which are around details, which we would like to have the opportunity with Scottish Funding Council and with Scottish Government to explore the specifics of. And if I can give you one tangible example of that, there is a somewhat historical SAS transfer, which is a transfer of almost £23 million a year from Scottish Funding Council to SAS, that was designed initially to pay for improving widening access. Now, widening access, of course, is now mainstreamed into the provision of universities, where we've been doing quite well. But that reallocation still is on the books. And there's a lack of clarity, let me leave it at that, there's a lack of clarity about whether that money actually is still required to to address the initial purpose, or whether that purpose has been met out of other budgets. So that's an opportunity for us to look at an amount of money which is not far off the £28.5 million reduction. Mm-hmm. So flexibility, a little bit more transparency and predictability, I think would be the very sage things that could immediately help us.
Mm-hmm. And I think, Shona, I'd like you to come in here as well. I think that framing around predictability, flexibility and transparency, and I note with interest how you're really talking in business terms, because that's exactly the sort of thing that businesses would look for. Is that something you would concur with, Shona, from the college sector, that as ever with these things, we've arrived in a place without necessarily looking back and saying, well, you know, we wouldn't necessarily have chosen to start from here, but is that a useful framing for you as well? And I'd appreciate your insights.
Well, I think
are we coming to Shona now?
Did you want me to respond?
Shona Struthers.
Yeah, okay, thank you. I mean, at the end of the day, colleges to our businesses, and we are not 100% funded by government through the Funding Council, so we have to go out there and bring in other income streams, commercial income streams, but again, the structure and the setup of colleges in the public sector makes that incredibly challenging. So what additional support would we be looking for? We would be looking for stability of our budget, so similar to what Ian's covered, but we need stability, because that stability has been lost, and then you want to get on to sustainability. We've seen some funding streams disappear, like Flexible Workforce Development Fund, mental health, etc. So all these things just add to a very difficult situation. I would like to see some movement on the reviews that we've been doing for the last year or so. There's £3.2 billion actually in the skills system. Everyone acknowledges that there's duplication. I don't see activity. I don't see changes. They may be coming. Mm-hmm. I think government giving clear priorities to colleges. We do so many things to so many markets and so many people. Actually, it would be, I think, much more helpful if government were clearer on what they want colleges to do. And then I think in terms of support going forward, we're looking for a five-year plan for the sector to bring that stability, to bring that predictability. And just as a point, you know, college students are the least funded students per head of all the education stages that you can go through, from preschool to primary, secondary and so on. And that just inherently feels unfair.
Mm-hmm. I mean, you've given us a lot of content there, and I know can other members are going to pick up on...
And Liam's got a wee pick up on that specific thread, if that's okay, Michelle. Sorry.
Thank you, Convener. Just Shona Struthers, I'll stick with you on that, because you brought up this five-year plan that you mentioned in your submission. So firstly, on that suggestion of a five-year plan, you've said, first of all, it should include a repurposing of an element of the overall skills and education resource. Yeah. So do you get any sense of a five-year plan? Has the government accepted the need for a five-year plan? If so, is it going to develop it? And what do you mean by a repurposing of the element?
Okay. Audit Scotland has raised this point, and it's about looking forward and having clarity and predictability of your funds. So if there's a five-year plan developed for the sector, and we're on this trajectory of if it's reducing funding, you would then see the consequences, and you could make decisions about whether you want to change that or not. So I would hope that the government would want to be involved in a five-year plan alongside Funding Council and colleges. Your second point you raised was about the repurposing. I mean, there are definitely duplication situations that go on in the sector, and I know that the reviews of Hayward and Withers have picked up on many of these issues, but I don't see activity around that. And I guess the Withers review has been out for a year now. So we're not asking perhaps for additional money, but we're asking for the money that's in the system to be used better than it currently is.
I understand. And a related point, of course, we've got the purpose and principles document, which I think was June 23 when that came out. Some might say it hasn't been extensively referenced since then. What's your view on that? And do you think colleges are clear on what the Scottish Government's expectations are of them this year and going forward?
Okay, so yeah, the government did come out with the purpose and principles, I presume vision, strategy for the sector. I think what the college sector then did is chairs and principals got together over the period of a year, and we met six times and we got together and we said, right, what does this mean in practice and what specific things can we ask the government to do to help the sector? And so we came up with many, many different solutions and examples. And so, for example, we've got, you know, put colleges at the forefront of the apprenticeship delivery. It's in the public sector. You have a structure there, so use them. Colleges first was the thing around that. We've asked for a funding model that's transparent, that's clear, that's fair, and we're working with the Funding Council on that in terms of making the flexibilities, but embedding those flexibilities in so that they're in with the model as it is. So, for example, the reduction in the credit target. So these are some of the things we've done, and we've also been, as a sector, looking at our workforce and what do we want our workforce to look like going forward. So we've taken the purpose and principles and we've made practical examples and working groups to try and take them forward. And I think that's to the credit of the sector to try and take these things forward, you know, working and feeding this back into government to give them updates on what we're doing.
Very grateful.
I was wondering if Gareth Williams had anything to comment in this sphere in terms of your perspective on things.
On funding specifically, or was there another
just the role of industry and how you feel that some of the non-financial support might be there? And in terms of the five-year plan, and is it really ticking the boxes in terms of what you'd be expecting from the college sector as well?
Yeah, I mean, I think we want to encourage a shift in thinking about how we think about investing education and skills over the longer term. And you know, we've done a lot of work with employers and the education sector in our membership on that theme. So we need to shift towards provision of lifelong learning at all stages of people's lives and careers to ensure that people and employers are better able to be ready for the significant changes in the economy that are coming. So, for example, net zero being an obvious one, but also the impact of digital. You know, and we expect people will have to transition between careers more frequently as they go through their working lives. So that point that Shona makes around about a five-year plan and a longer-term perspective is one that we would certainly endorse. And in our own written submission, you know, we've particularly highlighted areas around reskilling and upskilling as part of that. And to some extent, while those themes came through very strongly in the Withers Review, more recent funding decisions by the Scottish Government have taken us perhaps a step away from that provision. So we feel it's time to take stock and look to the longer term, as well as addressing some of the short-term financial pressures that have been outlined so far.
Okay, then we'll hopefully pick up on some of those themes as we move on again. I've got some questions now from Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thanks. You, Convener, and good morning to you all. Thank you for the information you sent in advance, which is rightly candid and stark in places, so it's much appreciated. I'd also just like to thank you for working in an extremely difficult environment and keeping on, because the tertiary education sector, as all of you have said, is crucial to Scotland, so thank you for that. My question is around the support that you've had, or otherwise, from the Scottish Government and the Scottish Funding Council so far. And first of all, I guess, to Shona Struthers, if that's OK, to ask about some of the flexibilities that were given to colleges around the credit thresholds. How helpful has that been, and is there anything further that you would need?
Yeah, thank you. Good morning, Pam. The sector has worked really closely with the Funding Council over the last year or so to ask for these flexibilities, and they've been very welcome for those colleges that needed it. So just to be clear, not every college is in the same situation. We actually do have some colleges that are in a growth scenario, so could take on more students, etc. But for those that have required that flexibility in delivering the credit target, it's been very welcome. So it's given colleges a bit of headroom to not deliver the same amount of credits but still receive the same amount of money. So that has been welcome. There's other work has been done on asset disposal, etc. So I think it's a fruitful and a helpful exchange to work with the Funding Council to look for these flexibilities. However, some of our members think that what's required is a more fundamental review of the funding model. It's a model that's been around for a long time. It's been based on, it's evolved from sums to credits, but it's essentially about inputs. And a lot of the members tell me that what they would prefer is a lot more trust, they want a lot of the scrutiny that goes on to be reduced. Now, that's from their perspective, so I'm sure you'll hear later from the Funding Council who will tell you another reason why there has to be that scrutiny. But there seems to be a lot of scrutiny on colleges who have multiple funding streams with a lot of audit around everything that they do, and a lot of restrictions on certain funds for certain things. So what that does to them is it constrains them in lots of ways, and they just want the ability to run their college, run it well, be audited as you would expect because it's public funds, but not be quite constrained.
What would need to specifically change to allow them to do that?
I suppose, some of the relaxations we've seen in the flexibilities in the Funding Council goes some way towards that, and some, parallels drawn with the university sector around, when you would need to return funds if a student was to, not carry on with their course. So they're welcome changes that have happened, but I think it's just a... Because most of the funding for a college does come from the Funding Council, and I think it's that element of trust is to have the money and then maybe a lighter touch in terms of the scrutiny that goes on. There's lots of returns that are done, FES returns, quarterly returns, mid-year returns and so on. It's quite an industry in colleges around that. And I think with resources becoming constrained, you might want to use those resources differently.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Can I also ask the same question of Professor Gillespie?
Too much time sitting in front of microphones and pressing the button, so apologies for that. I think flexibility is a key issue for us, as I've mentioned. Universities inherently have more flexibility than colleges because we're not public sector organisations. That's a very, very key status for us to continue to maintain. So we've been, I think, fairly flexible in the way that we've responded to challenges and opportunities that have come up. The difficulty is when changes are done to us at the last minute. In terms of our provision...
Sorry, Professor Gillespie, can I just interrupt? Forgive me. When you say that the difficulty comes when changes are made at the last minute, can you give us an example of what that could be?
Well, a change at the last minute was in our discussions around allocations of funded places into universities in this year, where that so-called SQA places, the 1,289 that I'd referred to earlier, they were moved from some universities, and the predictability of how these places were taken out of the system was, let's say, opaque until the last moment. And as we see the continuing financial pressures on government and on the sector and on budgets, which we fully understand, as we've mentioned before, in how any further adjustments are made to allocations,
what we need to be able to do is have a conversation so that we can understand exactly where cash will flow to. I think the back to, you know, the discussion we were having earlier, the more predictability that we have in the system going forward, the better we're able as a group of organisations to deal with the demands both of students and of government's requirements coming forward. And last minute shocks are always hard to deal with.
Thank you. That's really helpful. And now this question, I guess, is to both of you around support for articulation for students and whether or not the government and the SFC are giving you the right support to be able to ensure articulation works the way that it does as well. I don't know who wants to start.
Well, perhaps I'll start from a university perspective, then pass to Shona. The Scottish universities and colleges work incredibly closely together, despite the fact that we have different funding arrangements, we have different status. And articulation is very much on the up. We have very strong articulation between colleges and universities, and to a much, much lesser extent, if you like, some almost reverse articulation in university students getting opportunities for additional skills from colleges. From a university's perspective, the key challenge for us, if I'm very, very honest and very, very candid, rests on our colleagues in colleges' ability to have the flexibility and the resources to deliver education students that can articulate into universities. They are very, very constrained, and you know, Shona made the point earlier about the unit of resource that's applied to students in further education, and the real difficulties.
On that then, if that's the key, please. Just to keep the pace going, if that's all right, Professor. Thank you, Shona.
So I would agree that I think the articulation across colleges into universities, it's welcome, but it's the right thing to do. And I think where I see it working really well is where the two institutions come together and almost deliberately make sure the curriculum is developed so that it's almost a seamless transition through. And so that's what you'd have to replicate more if you wanted to see, I think, more articulation. In terms of the funding, I'm not aware that colleges get funding for it. I could be wrong on that, but I'm not aware of that. But I think we've worked long and hard as sectors together over many years to promote articulation, to increase it. And I think what that does do is certainly a lot of our students come through college and go on to university is it's all credit to both the organisations for making that happen. But of course, colleges deliver higher education with HNCs and HNDs in their own right, and a lot of industries see those qualifications at that level as the right qualification to go into industry with. But so for some of our students, it's absolutely the right thing.
Can I ask Professor McKendrick, please, because you've been online patiently there this morning, what concerns do you have about the impact of funding challenges on students coming from college to university?
So I think there are general issues, general challenges that go over and above the current funding challenges with college students progressing into university. I think both Professor Gillespie and Struthers are correct that it's a success story, but it's also a qualified success story. I don't think articulation is optimised. I think it works very well, but I think there is still room for improvement in terms, and I wouldn't necessarily agree with Shona in the sense that we have to look at curriculum and get the curriculum match between college and university. I think we have to have an acceptance of competency and the right ability of students to be accepted into the level that befits them. There are really interesting models, I think it's been mentioned as well, about the different ways in which colleges and universities can work. I mean, I was at the launch earlier this week of an undergraduate school, which is a partnership between New College Lanarkshire and the University of West of Scotland, a very different way, a much closer relationship. So I think there's already good practice. I think there is an excellent throughput to university from colleges. I would agree with Shona, it's not the only thing that's important about colleges. It's not the only higher education that's delivered in colleges, but I still think there's room for improvement in terms of acceptances of students' competency, which allows them to progress at the next level as they progress in their educational journey.
Thank you, because of course we want every young person to succeed to their very best ability, so that's a helpful contribution. Only if you actually follow the line of questioning we're looking for.
I absolutely will.
Thank you.
Thank you. Can I ask the panel, and particularly Professor Gillespie, what can be done to help institutions impacted by the removal of the Scottish Funding Council's funding towards the increased cost of employer pension contributions?
Touched on this earlier, I think, as well, Professor Gillespie.
So let me be very clear here. There's a £9.2 million gap because of the increase in the Scottish Teacher Pension Scheme. That's a 4.4 increase in costs and a 4.8 drop in support. That's very, very significant indeed on some specific institutions. And the candid and bleak answer to the question is provide support for employers' costs. That's the immediate thing. There's a secondary issue, which is what is the future of pension provision, but that's a much, much more difficult, much longer term question. And by the time that was answered, were it even addressed, the damage would be done. So the short term is provide some support for universities who are exposed to the Scottish Teachers' Pension Scheme.
Thank you. Thank you, Camilla.
Okay. Shona, you need to go. Okay.
It would be the same for colleges. It's just yet one more problem.
We understand that. So can I ask briefly, and hopefully, Gareth, you might be able to come in on this one as well. What measures can colleges and universities look at to bring in additional revenue? What were your thoughts? I know that's quite a short question, not giving you much time to ponder, but does someone want to come in first on that?
Well, okay. I'm happy to begin. If we look at where funding comes from, do we have an expectation that we will get some significant short-term increase in funding for Scottish domiciled students? Well, candidly, because of all of the conversation and the economic position at the moment, we do not. Longer term, we need a conversation about that. Do we expect that we will increase our margin, not just money in, but our margin on research? Again, fundamentally not, because research is structurally underfunded. So that essentially gives us two main areas for addressing income. One is international student income, and the second one is so-called other provisions. So, for example, spin-outs, commercialisation, bringing cash in through knowledge exchange and through commercial operations on site. There are, in that latter category, there are some options for us to do a little bit more, but we're not talking about significant inputs. The model is predicated on international student recruitment. And one way or another, universities are going to have to, in those that can, enable the future of international student recruitment. And one of the approaches that we're taking to that as a sector, or as a group of institutions at the moment, is to look at more provision outside Scotland, outside the UK. That, number one, will take time to deliver. Number two, it's risky. And number three, it's not available to all of our institutions. So we're all doing, within our individual institutional focus, what we can. Some institutions have more scope to do that than others.
And I know my colleague will come in specifically on international students later on. Shona, do you want to comment on...
Yeah, I mean, I suppose I'll for just... us, the all colleges will tell you that they do other funding streams because they have to balance their books because they're not 100% funded. So, you know, many of the colleges bring in additional income from tuition fees or commercial arrangements or bespoke training. So that's already going on. The problem you have when your core funding is on the decline, the capacity in the organisation to continue to look for other opportunities then becomes constrained, and that ability to work with employers and the time we need to invest in it just isn't there. And, you know, I'm thinking about the ONS challenges that brings with not being able to borrow or hold on to reserves. You don't have any money to speculate or to do some seed funding or anything. And then I think a great example that, you know, Gareth can definitely pick up would be around, we had the money for the Flexible Workforce Development Fund. It took a little while to get off the ground, but, you know, colleges certainly put a lot of effort into working directly with employers and running training courses, etc. And that took a lot of time and effort and infrastructure inside colleges. And then it was just taken away. So yeah. that was a great example of what we should be doing more of, but then it was just lost. And so I know many employers felt the same.
And that's certainly the feedback I've had from the college in my own region in Edinburgh. But Gareth, do you want to pick up on this?
Yeah, we've heard lots of examples since that decision was taken about the impact on employers, particularly SMEs, who don't have the money to invest in that kind of provision if there isn't that support from government. So that was a disappointing decision. But I think, you know, going back to what was being said about predictability, one of the disappointments was the uncertainty before the decision was taken. Ultimately a decision was taken to end that provision, and then subsequently to end the upskilling fund as well. So I mentioned earlier our concerns around provision of funding for upskilling and reskilling, and how that doesn't connect with economic need. I think more generally in terms of work with employers, I mean, there's many good examples of partnerships between universities, employers, colleges and employers. And our concern is that with fewer resources available, that will be one of the areas that that suffer, because institutions won't be able to spend the time with employers to take the risks in terms of developing the curricula aligned to industry need. So we must be very mindful of the economic impact of that. I think there are opportunities potentially in terms of research from UK's association with Horizon Europe, and I think that's something that we, you know, we need to maximise and ensure that we're in a competitive position, and that industry and education are working very closely together to maximise the opportunity there, and ensure that that association continues beyond this period. And on spin-outs, I think it's important that we do get a balance between recognising the investment in research that has created that knowledge and potential commercial activity against the risk that seeking too large a share of the percentage of that might dampen some of that spin-out activity. There are examples of good practice, I think, out there in Scotland and elsewhere that we need to follow to make sure that that doesn't happen.
Going back to the Flexible Workforce Development Fund and the delay, the length of time it took for the decision to be made, I knew of the uncertainty it was causing colleges and the disruption there. What was the impact on your members then, Gareth, of that prolonged, protracted wait?
Yes, I think many employers and colleges had training ready to go. Agreements were with what was needed, what was in place and how that would be supplied. And obviously that did then have an effect when there was this long period of uncertainty, both about the funding for last year and then the decision on whether it would continue into this year as well. So in the short term, a number of employers were able to switch into working with colleges and universities, utilising the upskilling fund, but then that was withdrawn as well. And so we're left in a position where there isn't that funding available. And you know, from what we hear from you know, particularly many SMEs, there's no way that they can self-fund that that important training.
And what's the risk then to some of these small businesses if they're unable to upskill their workforce? What pressure
does
that put on
them? We know that there's a productivity challenge in Scotland. That's a long-term productivity challenge. And we know that productivity growth is particularly weak among smaller businesses in the economy. So if we're going to address that, if we're going to ensure that they are successful and sustainable in the long term, then we need to make sure that they are able to upskill their workforce to take advantage of the opportunities in digitalisation and so on. Without that important funding from government, that becomes much less likely and harder for them to achieve.
Professor McKendrick, do you have any comments in this? You can shake your head if it's no, it's fine. So I just wanted to keep you on. Like, can I now come to Bill Kidd, please? That'd be great. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks very much, convener, and thanks, panel, for all your responses. I think they've been very helpful. Now, looking forward a wee bit to the Scottish Government budget in 2025-26, is there a way the Scottish Government will be able to use that budget to begin to address the issue of international student income being used to cross-subsidise the teaching of home students? Is there a way that the Scottish Government can use that budget to try and influence the money that comes from international students? And I know that Professor Gillespie had spoken a bit about this earlier, actually.
So, if I try and answer the exam question, is there something that can be done with the money available that would help us recruit international students, if I reframe it in that way? Would that be a correct reframe? Yeah. So I think the short answer to that is yes. When we're out going around the world, recruitment fairs, university partnerships, governments and the rest, Scotland always lands well. And Scotland lands comparatively well to a UK brand. So that sense of brand Scotland isn't just something that we Scots sitting here in Scotland believe to be the case. It is genuinely the case with students, with agents, with governments and with partners. It's our belief as a group of university principals that Scotland could do more together to present that brand welcoming place for Scotland to accept international students. And again, we could do some of that with some small amounts of support for marketing of Scotland as a Scotland and Scottish higher education as a brand overseas, but also more, which is about how we align our resources and our activities between universities and Scottish Government, and indeed third sector members, and how we present our position. And that, of course, would require some financial support to enable. So the amounts of money that, and I couldn't give you an exact figure at the moment, although we could certainly follow up on that if that was helpful, but the amounts of resources that we'd be requiring to do that would be really very modest indeed. But it would be about, if you like, taking that brand amplification of us as a country, as a sector, as a receiving environment, and make the point that Scotland is very open indeed to international students coming in. Then there's a second thing. If I may, convener, some of the rhetoric that we're hearing around more broadly at the moment, without being specific, is around how health provision is delivered to students, health support is delivered to students who come into the UK. And there is noise from south of the border at the moment around increasing the cost of health provision, which is a straight disincentive to international students coming in. Now, that's a different story in Scotland, but demonstrating, messaging out to international students that Scotland is a different place with Scottish Government in control of devolved powers, that makes life different here from government, not just from us, but from government, would be extremely helpful. It's a quite nuanced position, but it'll make a difference.
Well, Mr. Kidd, I've got a number of people wanting supplementaries as well, so I'll let you have a follow on and then we'll see where this goes. It's okay. Quite a topic.
Yeah, well, I mean, I know that is it's a major issue, and but I'm just wondering about the necessity, really, for universities and possibly colleges as well, in terms of cross-subsidising. I mean, you know, it's the money which is raised through international student numbers actually helping to maintain the funding available for home students from Scottish towns and cities. Is there a way of using that international money in order to support?
So if I can answer that very, very briefly, do we use money from international student fees to support and cross-subsidise provision of support for Scottish domicile students? Categorically, yes. Mm-hmm. And is there a way of using that cash to support provision to Scottish students? That's the fact of what we do today.
OK. Well, anyone else got some?
I mean, I would just add that there are some international students in the college sector, and there are some colleges that do have quite a significant proportion, and that does bring an income. But again, going back to the type of organisation that's in the public sector and the classification, is that you can't take reserves forward, etc. So even though it can be an income stream, there's constraints around that. And also that constraint then would stop colleges that don't have a big international contingent from actually developing that further.
Okay, thank you. Is that okay, everyone? Yep.
I'll just add that we know the importance of post-study work opportunities to international students. So we hope that those opportunities will be retained by the next UK government. And I think there is more that we could do between universities, colleges and employers to take advantage of that opportunity and encourage more employers to recruit people on those post-study work opportunities.
Thank you. And Professor McKendrick, in order to help with the fair access element for students home domiciled, do you think this the numbers of international students does actually help towards ensuring fairer access and providing better opportunities?
I'm very glad you asked the question, Bill. I think to some extent it could, in theory. Obviously it does, as Professor Gillespie noted, it brings more money into the system. But I don't think it's a resource that's unproblematic, because we have a quantum of resource to develop universities. And if that resource has been used to support international students, then clearly that gives us less scope to be innovative and have a focus in widening access. And also, I think international students require support. So I'd be very interested to find out, and I don't think the intelligence is there, the extent to which supporting international students actually perhaps divest resources from supporting those students at university who require that little bit of transition, that little bit of support in their studies to progress and prosper. Now, I absolutely don't want to pit one against the other. I mean, I need to be 100% clear about that. International students are good for Scotland, they're good for Scotland's universities, but it's not an unproblematic resource in terms of widening access. It does present challenges.
OK. Okay, thank you. I think that's something that could be useful when we get
the
report.
Yeah, helpful. Yep, can you. I have got Ben McPherson and Willie Rennie looking for supplementaries on this? So Ben McPherson first, please.
Thank you, Convener. And with appreciation for the points the Commissioner's just made, I think it's important to emphasise that international students not only make a contribution to universities, but several of them, many of them, stay in Scotland and are huge contributors to our economy and our public services going forward. Three follow-up questions. First of all, Professor Gillespie, you spoke earlier about a 20% reduction in international students. I just wondered if you could explain in general terms at least what the causal factors are of that 20% reduction. Secondly, there was some mention of the NHS surcharge. My understanding is that that is fully reserved as a policy decision under immigration policy. So even though healthcare is devolved, the NHS surcharge cannot be influenced by the Scottish Government through devolved powers. And I've got a third question.
Okay.
Just lastly as well, you spoke about how there could be further coordination around promoting Brand Scotland. My understanding is through the Scottish Government External Affairs Division and also the various connections that it engages in, there is already significant work ongoing in promoting Brand Scotland and our university offer as part of that. Are you acknowledging that and saying that that could continue to be enhanced and developed, but we're already in a healthy place? And if you could clarify those three points, that would be helpful. Thanks.
Perhaps take them in reverse order. That might be simplest. So I think all concerned would agree that the conversation about promoting Brand Scotland and the role of universities in that and Scotland's international education policy has been rather slow in coming, but it has now landed. And what we all look forward to is a stronger partnership in making that a reality. And so hence my comments around the budget, to have some support to make that a stronger reality. So I think my honest answer to you on that is yes, now. If I'd been asked that question 2 or 3 months ago, I'd have probably been saying that we're still waiting for something. So the opportunity is here now. On the NHS surcharge, I stand corrected, thank you for that. On the causal factors of downturn in international student enrolments, broadly speaking, there are three. One is visa policy. So there have been two significant threats around visa policy. One was the removal of dependence visas from January this year. And that had a particular impact on students from Africa, had impact on students from South Asia as well, but particularly on students from Africa, fundamentally because the model for supporting students from Africa was that students from Africa would have their families come together and provide support for them, their fees, bring their families with them, who would often then work in the care sector, and not just support the provision of care in Scotland, but also support the spouse to go through universities. So the fact that the dependence visa has been removed has caused, associated with a very significant decline in students from, particularly from Nigeria, but elsewhere. Second visa element is the threat around the post-study work visa, which you'll all be aware, the Migration Advisory Committee advised on a few weeks ago. And at least in the short term, changes to the graduate route have not been made, and that's very positive. We still wait to see what the impact of that more positive, or at least less negative outcome is on student recruitment this year. That would be something that we'd have to come back to the committee on once the cycle's complete in October. But that has had a very significant diminishing effect. About 70% of international students cite the post-study work visa as an attractive element for coming studying in the UK. So visa policies had a very significant impact. Economic performance in some of the sending nations has had a real challenge, particularly in Nigeria, where we've seen two devaluations of the currency, the Naira. and that's made coming to study in the UK, Scotland or elsewhere in the UK, less affordable. And the third one is around global shocks, whether it's pandemic or economic downturn or security dimensions. And we've seen global shocks also pushing down some of the student flow here.
Thank you. It shows it's a very complex situation and it's not quite as straightforward as some people. Can I bring in Willie Rennie, please, to move the...
I mean, it is partly on what the Professor's just been talking about. This is not a simple solution. You are being forced down a route, taking in ever greater numbers of international students in order to subsidise the domestic provision. And you've talked about global shocks in some of the individual countries, and that could happen. I mean, if it happened in China, let's be blunt, if China was to invade Taiwan, the shock on UK universities would be significant and we'd be back to square one with the finances. I'm slightly puzzled today, I have to say, because the reports I hear about the financial situation in both colleges and universities is much more stark than you've presented this morning. And I'm wondering why you're holding back, why you're much more cautious, because this is your opportunity to tell the government that things are stark and that if we don't take action now, there could be real life consequences. We've talked about lost opportunities for the future, but my concern is what students are losing out on now. And I'm just puzzled as to why there's the caution, because the international student market is really important, but we can't be over-dependent on that. So tell me what's going on. I don't quite understand why there's the caution.
Professor Gillespie.
Well, I'm speaking for a sector. I speak for my own university, I can be much less cautious, but I'm speaking for a sector. So that's point one. The second point is I've been very precise in asking some very, answering some very precise questions here this morning. And what I've not said is where the financial risks stand if the situation that we're in now continues for another year or two, because then we will see real problems in the sector. I was asked very specifically, if I can reiterate, forgive me, the question, do I see the risk of closures of universities now? And the answer to that is no, because we have the abilities to mitigate the financial pressures right now. If this continues, by which I mean a decline in international student numbers and no change in the funding model for the next 2 or 3 years, then I think risks will increase, and there we are likely to see universities really struggle to deal with the financial challenges that are around at the moment. I cannot comment on whether there will be failures or not, that's for them, but the problems will and are accumulating. And so the question about doing something now is doing something now, which is for us a conversation about what is the future funding model, how do we deliver that long-term sustainability, that inevitably is a conversation that will take time. So we must begin it now in order to head off the difficulties coming at us 2 or 3 years down.
Willie, before you go in again, can I please bring in Professor McKendrick online? Thanks.
Yeah, thank you. And it's a very similar point to the one Professor Gillespie has just made. Widening access in particular operates in trust and goodwill. There are a specific funding stream, but much more of the funding that supports this work and the capacity to do so is a belief in the agenda of universities. If the resource gets strained ahead, in the years ahead, then it will make it much more difficult for us to continue to make progress in this particular area.
Sean, yeah, briefly. I'm very conscious of the time now. If people are aware, I know this is a really so I'm just framing everything in that context.
I would say I don't recognise what you've just said there. I think I've been quite stark and quite blunt to say that if the restoration of college funding doesn't take place, that will be in our budget submission. If you don't invest in colleges going forward, there will be major issues that we will not be able to achieve. And if I look at the First Minister's priorities that have just come out in recent weeks, eradicating child poverty, addressing net zero, economic activity, colleges will deliver on all of them. So if you don't invest in colleges, you will not deliver your Scottish Government priorities. I can't really be more blunt than that.
Okay. Thank you. Liam Kerr now, please. Thank you.
I'm very grateful, Convener. I'll stick briefly, Professor Gillespie, on the points that have just been put to you. On the cross-subsidising through international students issue, you said right at the start, home students lose money. At the weekend, Sir Paul Grice, who's the Vice Convener of Universities Scotland, said that the Scottish Government had not met its part of the deal on funding its free tuition policy. Given that we're coming into the budget, as Bill Kidd was talking about, what does meeting its part of the deal look like from the Scottish Government? And if it did that, would that mitigate against over-reliance on international students?
So, if meeting the deal for funding of domestic students for me means paying the costs of tuition, and we are far away from paying the costs of tuition through government funding for Scottish DOM students. Would that remove the requirement to rely on international students? It would neither remove requirements nor would it remove the desirability, because international student income cross-subsidises provision of tuition for Scottish DOM students. It also cross-subsidises research. So if we wanted to see our universities drive research and drive the economy, at the moment, because of the structural underfunding of research in the UK, which is particularly acute in Scotland, we remain reliant on international students. And international students, as members have commented elsewhere, bring very considerable benefits both to the experience of Scottish students at universities, to the research capabilities, and to our contribution to the economy.
I'll stick with you on this, but I am going to come to Seán Struthers in 2 seconds. Just the committee's heard concerns about cuts to funded places having a disproportionate impact on the post-92 universities. What are the implications for those institutions, in your view, and indeed Scottish domiciled students? But related to the previous point you've just made, what do you think the Scottish Government could be doing with the money that it's not now using on those funded places?
Increasing the unit of resource for Scottish DOM students.
Nice answer, Liam.
Thank you very much. Seán Struthers, I'll finish. This will be my final question, Convener. The SFC statistics show a significant fall in full-time students at college, but there's been a significant increase in enrolments of part-time students. Can you help the committee understand what might be driving that trend towards more part-time enrolments at college? And are there any implications on the costs of provision of part-time courses from the colleges?
Yeah, so I'll keep it brief as well. When you look at the trends, where it used to be most of the students were full-time, that was a government policy to bring in students full-time to address youth unemployment. And it was a very successful policy, actually, because we did see the unemployment levels come down. So what you've now seen over the last 8-10 years is a switch from full-time to part-time. And it's for many reasons, actually, that people study part-time, because they've got other commitments. It's quite a commitment to be full-time at college, so they might be carers, they might have jobs. And also people want to study modular and do bite-sized qualifications. So that switch to part-time, we've seen that trend. And so actually in full-time numbers, they've stayed the same. They've just moved from full-time to part-time. And the consequences of that for colleges is actually delivering part-time courses are more expensive.
Very interesting.
I was wondering, John McKendrick, if you could maybe comment on that impact on the widening access theme from the move from full to part-time, but also in terms of what Mr Kerr was asking about the cuts impacting disproportionately on the post-92 universities and that widening access, what are your views and do you share the concerns? What concerns do you have and what actions might be taken in that to address some of that? Professor McKendrick.
I think it's right we maintain a focus. I don't have strong concerns that it will have a negative impact in the agenda. I think we should be focused on it and we should monitor it and make sure it doesn't. But the universities make the decision about who enters university. It doesn't necessarily follow that because there are fewer places, it means the disadvantaged students. And we talk about disadvantaged students rather than disadvantaged areas. Very importantly, there's a very subtle and important difference between the two. But it doesn't necessarily follow that in a restricted funding environment, the disadvantaged students will be more adversely affected because it's up to universities the decisions they make. So universities still have to be held to account for their share. Now, I can understand it becomes more complex and more different. And there's a context through which university students, applicants, ready themselves for application. But it does not follow that this will have a negative impact on the throughput to university from disadvantaged areas.
Jonah, you're looking... You're all right. Yeah. Pam Duncan Glancy's got a sup on this theme as well, so if I bring her in now, thanks.
Thank you, Convener. I just want to explore the theme of widening access a little bit more on that. So my first question is about on widening access is around the post-92s and those universities have a particular reputation in terms of widening access. So could I ask maybe Professor Gillespie what he thinks the impact on widening access and the reduction to those universities' funding could be?
Online first, please. Professor McKendrick.
Sorry.
That's okay. No, you're on. You're on.
Yeah. So it does it again. I think it's really important that we think about individual students. It's also not just a post-92 agenda. There are significant contributions made by institutions, particularly in West Central Scotland, that are not post-92s. Because the metric that we currently use, the area-based measure, is very geographically uneven where these students reside. So it's a particular challenge in West Central Scotland. If the resources squeezed in West Central Scotland, it's as much a challenge for Glasgow as it is for West of Scotland and Caledonian. I do understand the point about the reduction in places in UWS in particular. I think it's something that we have to monitor. But as I say, let me reiterate, it's up to universities who they choose to accept. University entrance policies work the way that they should with contextualised admissions and with that ecosystem of support that is providing those opportunities for not just school students, remember, we also must remember adult access to university, largely through articulation, but also through access schemes is very important. And if these schemes are working properly, then it should not have an adverse impact on the direction of travel for widening access.
Does anyone else want to come in on that? Oh, Professor Gillespie. There's two.
If I can, briefly... For us, one of the biggest challenges, well, perhaps two big challenges for bringing students in and widening access. One is the attainment gap in schools that remains stubborn and needs to be addressed. And for us, that's probably a bigger challenge than how we decide to apply our funding. From a specific funding issue, the difficulty is around sometimes complex needs to support widening access students once they come into universities. But essentially, there's one pot of money, and it's for institutions to decide how to spend that. So it's the bigger challenge is the throughput of students from schools at the moment.
Universities given an explanation as to why, because the government have said that the reduction was a result, or the SFC said the reduction was a result of them not filling all their places. Have any of those universities explained why that might have been the case?
Well, I think that would have to be a question that you pick up with SFC and the individual universities, because there are a relatively small number of universities affected here.
I'm sure the member will do so, the second panel. Thank you for your patience, Ross Greer. Can we come to yourself now? Thank you.
Thanks, Convener. First question is for Shona, if that's okay. It's around state of industrial relations in colleges, a very familiar topic. It's been quite some time now since the Strathesk report was published. We've had the response from employers and the response from unions. We're now waiting on government's proposals to take things forward. Obviously, in the intervening period, we are locked into another round of national industrial action over a pay dispute. Do you think there has been any progress around national collective bargaining and industrial relations since the Strathesk report was published?
I know that the Minister is holding conversations with employers and trade union representatives who have, shall I say, not a lot of experience of being in the room, but maybe a fresh approach. So people like myself, who've been involved in national bargaining since the very beginning, I've not contributed to that group, but I think it's a way that the Minister's trying to break a deadlock or to try and get some fresh thinking to see how things can be progressed and moved forward. So I think that's to be welcomed. It is regrettable that we move into another round of industrial action, and no more so than for the students, because my worry is that the sector is tarred with that as a reputation, and that it impacts the wider society and people who might want to come to college. So I think it's regrettable.
On the wider issue of fair work, I'd be interested in your understanding of SFC funding conditions and how they evaluate outcome agreements. So from the best I can gather, colleges' commitments to fair work, where they are tied in, conditioned in around funding, it's as part of the outcome agreement. Are you aware of how or if the SFC evaluates whether a college has actually met its fair work obligations?
I'm not aware of that. I'm sorry. It's probably a better question for the next panel.
Yeah, I've been working my way through everybody who's come in advance of the next panel who are getting tip-off.
I can tell you the aspects of fair work, and I can tell you all the different things that colleges do to address that. So I know that our colleges take the fair work agenda very seriously, and there's lots of great examples where they demonstrate that. But in terms of how they're held to account for funding, that's probably a better question for SFC.
On a similar line of question, Professor Gillespie, obviously your university funding situation is different. Universities are not in the public sector, so fair work applies a bit differently. But how are universities evaluated for their commitment to fair work insofar as it relates to their public funding that they receive?
Well, I think, again, it's a conversation for SFC through how they evaluate the outcome agreements, I'm afraid.
And on your local individual universities' fair work agendas and their relations with trade unions, obviously the major point of dispute in the university sector has primarily, not entirely, but it's primarily been about pensions as a UK-wide issue over recent years. But do you think there are points for improvement in the Scottish sector specifically? And is there a role for the Scottish Government there beyond the obvious? If there was more money in the sector, there would probably be less unrest as such. But is there a role for the Scottish Government in improving industrial relations in the university sector? Or, in your view, should that be left up to the institutions and the unions?
So University of Scotland doesn't have a locus on collective bargaining around paying conditions. That's done through a different organisation, yeah. USEA. So if you forgive me, I'd defer that to a conversation with USEA.
Grant, thank you very much.
Pam Duncan-Clancy, you have a supplementary finally on for this.
Thank you, Convener. I'll be brief. The Scottish Funding Council have said in the report that there's a risk that there could be 21% full-time equivalent staff lost in the college sector as a result of the budget and the finances. Can I just ask Shona Struthers just to briefly comment on what the impact of that would be on your sector?
Well, I think it would be catastrophic. I think the impact would have on students. If you've got less staff running colleges, it would impact on the curriculum offering. It would impact on the pastoral support that staff give to students, and also then just puts an extra burden on those staff that are there to perhaps try and deliver more with less. So it's a real dampening down of the ability of colleges to just keep cutting away and cutting away without clarifying exactly what it is that government would like colleges to do. So if you're not going to invest, at least be clear about what it is that you don't want delivered. So a bit of double negatives in there. I would much rather see investment in colleges and letting colleges thrive, and therefore, you know, staff that are in it can thrive and the students benefit. So if you're going to keep cutting the budgets, it's just dire.
Okay, thank you very much. That brings our first evidence session of the morning to a close, and I'd like to thank the witnesses for their time this morning. We're now going to have a suspension till 10:50 to allow for a change of witnesses. I now suspend the meeting, and can I ask that the gallery please be cleared as well? Thank you. Welcome back. And we're now going to hear evidence from representatives from the Scottish Funding Council, who got a little bit of a preview this morning. They were name-checked a few times. So can I welcome Karen Watt, the Chief Executive Officer, Richard McConaughey, Director of Finance, and Lynn Rayside, Deputy Director of External Affairs. Thank you. And I think we'll go straight to members' questions. And I'd like to thank you for your written submission, which we have found particularly helpful in scoping out the session. Can I bring in, to kick off this panel, Liam Kerr, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. Karen Watt, I'll go straight to you. We've heard a great deal this morning, and in general, about the significant financial challenges facing our institutions. And I think it's important to note Professor Gillespie's comments earlier that the stewardship, they're navigating the situation carefully within the institutions themselves. But what support is the SFC offering to these institutions to help them navigate these current financial challenges?
Thanks very much. Yes, it is an extremely difficult funding environment for both colleges and universities at the minute. And we have a number of ways that, as a funding council, we can support, help and think about this. The first thing is about being fair about how we distribute the money. So we don't set the overall budget, but we do distribute it in ways that are fair and will be important to how students and institutions thrive. So first of all, we have made changes to the way that we have done some of our funding distribution, particularly for colleges where we have looked at the threshold levels, tolerance levels for under and over delivery. We have looked at a more generous and fairer way of looking at when we recover funds. So we have a range of those kind of mechanisms in terms of how we distribute, but also how we recover funds when things are not being delivered well. We also monitor things very closely. And when we see institutions getting into difficulty, and you will know we have published material which we do regularly on the financial state of colleges and universities, you will know that there are a small number of colleges that we are working extremely closely with because they do have quite significant cash flow difficulties, and we're working on a range of measures, and I'm very happy to talk about that if that's useful. But tell me, is there a particular way you would like me to explore something in more particular aspects?
It will not surprise you to know that my follow-up question, which I shall also direct directly to you, Karen, is that in January, you told, I think, the Public Audit Committee that four colleges were facing, I think you said, fairly significant cash flow issues.
Yes.
So could you give this committee an update on, first of all, those four and where they are now, but also the rest of the estate more generally?
Yes. Well, almost in reverse order, the general picture then is, I would say, a very high proportion of colleges are actively looking to reduce operating deficits. So we are seeing a number of colleges that are working very hard at this. So when we get mid-year review forecasts in, so that tells us what is happening this academic year, we are seeing a forecast underlying operating deficit of about 17 million. Now, that is actually 7% better than they were forecasting originally, which shows that there are activities in play at colleges that to deal with this. But it is a big deterioration on the surpluses that were being posted even as soon ago as 21-22. We're seeing a reduction in cash balances across the entire college sector. So when we look at these specific small number of colleges that are having cash flow issues, the first thing to say is we will support recovery plans. We want students to keep studying. We will stabilise things with the college sector and with these four institutions. We work with them very closely to get to the heart of the issues. We dedicate time and energy to this, We have direct engagement with the board, with the senior teams, with the finance directors. We have practical things we can do. We can bring forward and reschedule grant. That helps a lot with cash flow. We can provide repayable grants or temporary cash funding if it's a significant liquidity issue. All of this in order to stabilise an organisation sufficient that they can have a recovery plan and that they can look to their future and have plans in place. We can consider funding voluntary exit schemes if they have not got the cash immediately in hand to do that. We can defer loan repayments. And we can sometimes put specialists in where we feel they may not have at their own hand the kind of expertise we might they might need. Now, all of this is also to say institutions themselves need to do some things. So they need to engage with us. They need to give us the information we're looking for. They need to help put a costed plan together. And the four we're working with at the minute are looking at across the base at where their costs lie, where their underpinning cost drivers are. They are making conscious choices about those costs and about value, and I mean wider social value. So a lot of these colleges are helping people who are furthest from the labour market, and this isn't a purely commercial issue. It is actually about how do they want to manage their offer, their curriculum offer over time. So we look at all of this and work with them to put a recovery plan in place, and we have these measures, quite practical measures on cash flow that we are actively working with them on. Is that helpful?
I understand, and just for the avoidance of doubt, those measures that you've outlined presumably are available to all colleges, not simply the four that you're working very closely with.
Some of them, yes. Some, like the rearrangement potentially of cash flow repayments and how we schedule grant. We can do that for a number of colleges, but I'm talking about a specific package of measures where it's quite concentrated if we have colleges in particular difficulties.
I understand. Very grateful.
Willie Rennie, you want to come in here?
Yes, so you've focused on the finances. We've not really talked about what getting those finances under control actually means, and I presume you measure that as well, and the impact of the reduction in the offer. So I'd be interested in just what's your assessment of the basically the consequences of doing these financial measures?
Yes, one of the very significant issues we will look at is we take the picture in the round. So for some, it is too early to say because we're stabilising a situation and they will need to put longer term plans in place. So some of these institutions have started curriculum reviews. And what we do expect is them to look at, are there ways that they can put some courses together potentially? Where are the courses where they possibly have fewer student numbers and they can still support those students but provide the curriculum in a different way? And I think also we're looking at opportunity as well as issues of possibly consolidating some curriculum areas. So looking at the regional lead, has a college in particular situation maximised the opportunities that they can have regionally and locally? We also expect them to review their estates. So when we're looking at this, we're trying to get a balanced picture so that a college can still meet regional need, can still look at opportunity, but they are doing it from a more stable position so they can actually manage those opportunities and that those challenges. So our initial, for some of these institutions in difficulty, it is about a broader business planning opportunity for them in the future.
So I have an immediate concern on two fronts. One is basically if we move more courses online, particularly for sometimes a vulnerable group of people who are getting into the educational establishments and looking for future careers. Online might not always work for this particular cohort. Secondly, when the regionalisation programme was introduced, we were told this wasn't really just about centralising course provision, because younger people who go to colleges are less likely to travel from their own community. So on both fronts, have you got concerns about going more online and about the kind of centralisation, even if it is at a regional level?
Yes, I mean, I think that the way colleges and universities dealt with the COVID pandemic showed that actually you can have a blend. Now, you're right, there needs to be the right blend and the right mix. And for some students and some subject areas, it simply does not work. For others, yes, it can be a possibility. So I think it's about exploring what works for particular subjects, for particular student cohorts. And colleges are in the business of supporting people to succeed. So they are very mindful of that when they're looking at provision. And we would be worried if we were seeing whole-scale online provision. But that's not what we're seeing. We're seeing a real blend and a real opportunity to look at different ways. We're not seeing so much centralisation, but I think there are opportunities for curriculum development to in some areas. And I'm thinking, for example, you will be well aware, I think it is, we have said this ourselves, we're looking very closely, for example, at the colleges in the Highlands and Islands region, where it is very clear that multi-college regions, we have done a fundamental review of that. We are working very closely with UHI and with those partner colleges. Now, there are opportunities in that kind of setup to develop curriculum in particular ways, which can still keep delivery local, but may have more cost-effective ways of developing the curriculum.
Okay. Emma, the final question is, all of this, how do you feed this back to government? Because I'm not sure government fully understands what the cuts I would describe as are having on students. How do you feed that back?
So in the run-up to budget settlements, we have a role in providing information. We model different options and we are explicit about the implications of each of the options that we model. We provide global information at a national level about the college and the university sector. So we publish much more than we have ever published before, probably over the last 3 or 4 years, on the state of the nation in terms of what's happening in terms of those fundamental flows of both financial sustainability, but also impacts on students and a range of other risk factors. And where we have institutions that are facing very significant issues that may require some broader form of intervention, we will make those known to the government.
So one final question, if it's okay. Do you agree with Shona Struthers when she said earlier on she's never seen it like this before?
So I think it is very difficult. If you're looking at the long term, I would say that the budgets for colleges have... over that 10-year period, they have declined in real terms by about 3% for universities. It has been a decline, a longer and deeper decline in the real value of the budget settlement by about 14%. I think it's really difficult. And I think a lot of college principals, and I would strongly agree with Shona, that this is a very difficult time. A lot of educators didn't come into education to make the kind of difficult decisions that they're making now. And they're trying to balance a range of factors. They're trying to balance the fact that almost 75% of their income comes from the SFC, one source. As public bodies, they cannot really generate the same or an increased level in commercial activity. So I would say it's an extremely difficult time. And I think the issue is how quickly can some institutions adapt to a change in funding circumstances? And sometimes adaptation requires funding. And we don't have, at the minute, funding for transformation or change. And that does make the transition to a different operating environment more complex.
Okay. Apologies.
No, that's okay. And I suppose a mechanism for how you feed back to Scottish Government some of your concerns is our responsibility here in committee. So you've got some of those on record. Michelle Thompson. Over to yourself now.
Good morning. Thank you for joining us. I want to follow up on what was a sort of slightly technical discussion earlier, where I was in conversation with Professor Ian Gillespie, and the framing of it was that some people have said that institutions were a result of failure in Scotland, and between my colleague Willie Rennie and myself, we asked him a number of questions, and he explained that he thought that these are my words, that probability was low because of the prudent nature of their gearing being set to 30% against fee income to debt ratio. First quick question is that something that's set by yourselves, that limit, or is that something that's in the Articles of Associations for universities? Why is it there's such a prudent regime in Scotland compared to what's happening with universities elsewhere in the rest of the UK?
Yes, it's a good question, and we do keep very close to lenders, and we monitor loans and loan repayments very carefully. And I do agree with Ian, that I think, you know, the sector has been, it is careful, it is well managed, it is financially adept at looking at all of this, and it hasn't, it in our experience, it is not particularly overexposed on debt at this time. Mm-hmm. But it is a completely different funding model, so it's quite difficult, I think, to make a comparison with England and elsewhere, because they are dealing in a different financial environment. If it is helpful, I would say that in our look at lending and private placements, what we are seeing is an increased, almost a more kind of flexible lending covenants coming through. So we're seeing revolving credit facilities increasing. Some of the private placements that we have are not due yet, so the sector is very aware that they have a financial set of arrangements with lenders, which mean they have big bullet payments to make at particular points mm-hmm. in time. As far as we are concerned, those payments are on track to be made. Lenders themselves, when we engage with them, say they see, I would summarise it as they see the sector going through choppy waters, but they remain fairly confident that they are resilient, and they are extremely confident in the sector compared with other sectors that they lend to. So in our engagement, and we track some of the same issues that lenders will track, there is a high degree of confidence and continued confidence in the sector, which really matters. Now, that doesn't mean there aren't risks and that there aren't issues emerging. So clearly the downturn in international recruitment is something that we're tracking, that lenders are tracking, and the institutions themselves are very acutely aware of. And that will have an impact. So when we're looking at recruitment in the autumn and then into January 25...
Well, if you don't mind, before we move on to that, I just want to be clear in my own head that in terms of this prudent regime, which Ian Gillespie outlined, is that set by the Scottish Funding Council, setting aside the risk profiling that commercial lenders will undertake, but is that prudent regime set by yourselves?
We do not set the kind of parameters that
And where are they set then? Are they set in Articles of Association?
So each institution will set their own appetite for risk. Beg your pardon.
No, I was just going to say it's set by the university court.
Okay.
We do have a role in reviewing renewals or applications for revolving credit facilities. So we look at the business case for that and the covenant.
Okay. So I'm just, the reason I'm labouring this point is that until this came up this morning, I'd heard narrative that they talk about the UK university sector, but if you look at it from a financial perspective, the risk is utterly, fundamentally different in Scotland as compared to the rest of the UK when you look at their level of average gearing, which I did post that first session. So it's therefore not true to say that the risks to institutions in Scotland are the same. And thank you for clarifying around the university courts. In terms of the colleges, do you set kind of fiscal rules in terms of attitude to debt and deficit as the Scottish Funding Council, just so I can understand that as well?
Yes, we are more involved in that because they're public bodies, okay, and they have to balance their books. So the rules are possibly less set by us, but more by their status.
As public sector institutions.
As public
institutions.
Bodies, so they can generate surplus, but they have to either spend it in the year, donate it to an arm's length foundation in that year that they generate it. So they can't carry over huge amounts of surplus or debt. You know, they need to be very careful about balancing their books as they go.
And it kind of leads me on to my next question in terms of, I suppose I would term it as kind of fiscal flexibilities for colleges. We've heard a lot of talk. At the moment, we're stuck in the trap of there's not enough money, we need more money, when we know that the wider financial environment's very, very challenging. What's your thinking thus far in terms of fiscal flexibilities, particularly for colleges and particularly against where we've got this situation that the public sector bodies? Are you having those kind of discussions and considerations?
We are, and Richard is part of a tripartite group that's looking at that with government, if you want to say some more about that, Richard.
Well, just add that, yes, we're very much aware of the fiscal pressure on colleges. Nobody could ignore that. And we recognise the constraints that being public sector has. It also has some advantages as well, because there is a degree of protection there as well, which the colleges can rely on. But we're involved in, through the tripartite group, SFC brought forward the idea of trying to, incentivise colleges to dispose of assets through making lighter disposal rules so they can keep some of the proceeds of disposals. So we're looking at other ways to get round some of the constraints of being in the public sector.
Okay.
But we understand that, you know, the pie is the pie. That's controlled by us.
Part of the issue. And what sort of non-financial support do you feel you would benefit from getting from the Scottish Government? Because this has been, obviously, being a pre-budget session, we're terribly focused on the finance, but are there areas where you'd like to see more non-financial support? I mean, I perhaps alluded to it by saying fiscal flexibilities, but there could as well be other areas.
I think when we talk to government, what we are most interested in is maximising wherever we can flexibility. So as Richard said, can colleges retain more of the receipts rather than putting it into a big pot that goes into a number of other priorities? Hugely important. We would like to see multi-year funding settlements. Now, it's not exactly a flexibility, but it's about how you plan. It's about that whole issue of stability. We do think that there are flexibilities around activity targets, things like this, which actually constrain as well as incentivising, that governments could look at. One of the issues which I think was raised in your previous session was less about fiscal flexibility and more about flexibility in general around different funding pots. So we're a funding council. Mm-hmm. We get £2 billion to distribute. Some of that, though, comes as discrete and distinct pots of money and with architecture and rules that are made elsewhere. I think there is a role for government to think about what kind of rules and restrictions they put on particular funding and whether or not those could be more flexible. And also the multiple funding pots. So thinking very carefully from that perspective about a college receiving lots of different funding streams with lots of different requirements attached is, I think, something which is on us and the government to look at differently.
You've been very clear. Thank you. My last wee question, just to finish off this section. We've heard a lot of chat in recent months about almost encouraging Scotland to move to a fee model for universities similar to what they've got elsewhere. But from a purely business perspective, I was staggered when I went away and looked at this morning and looked at the perilous state of some of the English universities, despite the fee model and because of the gearing ratios. So it doesn't seem quite as simple as that when we start to look at the kind of financial provisioning of our education thing. And so within that, how actively are you having conversations with government to almost look afresh at how we all get a bit of something that we want, i.e. flexibility? I appreciate you've said multi-year funding, that's a common refrain, and rightly so. How active are those discussions, not just your tripartite group, but is there a sense of urgency, the same sense of urgency, I guess?
So just to be clear, we are not actively working on a tuition fee model. We are a funding body and we are part of the Scottish Government family, so that is not part of our discourse. However, we are actively talking about, within a no fees situation, what can be done in with the envelope that is here. And I do think, particularly for colleges and universities, we do need to look at the funding model. So, for example, where we distribute funded places, we have a historic pattern. Actually, there's a question about patterns of under-delivery, of reduced and increased demand. Have we got the places in the right place? For universities, I think the question is also, how do we pay? How much do we pay for those? Now, at the minute, I think it is fair to say we have more funded places in the university system than we have had pre-COVID or for quite some time. Some universities are struggling to fill those places. There is a question, and that's partly because in 2021 we had 15,000 EU students filling our funded places. As that cohort has graduated every year, those funded places still remain in the system. Now, the question might be, what do you want to do with the funding that is in those funded places? Do you want to redistribute it? Do you want to take it and look at the unit of resource and think more imaginatively about that? Because that has seen a real term decline over the last 10 years. These are the kind of active conversations that we're having. So it's, where do we put the funded places? How are those funded places being used? Do we want those to be used purely for undergraduate? How much do we want for postgraduate taught students? How much do we want to expand the graduate apprenticeship schemes using those funded places? So I guess it's about how we use the money, where we put those funded places, and what we are willing to pay for some of those funded places. Those are the critical questions, I think, for the future and for the next few years.
Okay, thank you.
I suppose on that, can I ask how you make those decisions to allocate your £2 billion. I mean, I've got an example here of Robert Gordon University. It's getting 4.3% less, the third deepest cut of all. So how did you decide to do that? And just on a broader, so how are you making those decisions on a university, on an institution basis?
Thank you. So every year we model different options for how we distribute those places. We agree principles to start with about what we are trying to do with those funded places. So, for example, maximising opportunities for new students coming into further and higher education. If you're looking specifically at the university sector, what we do is a fair and transparent look across the evidence that we have and what policy parameters we have. So this year, we were asked to make sure that no more than the 1,289 additional places in total came out of the system. We were asked to protect widening access. So none of the premiums that we put into our funding model for widening access should be removed. And we were very clear that where there were under delivery in places that we would take that into account. So we model across all of these different options keeping opportunities for fair access, keeping vulnerable learners in place, making sure that we protect the unit of resource, and we also protect some of our small specialist institutions, and we model how many places we have and how that should be distributed across the place. So this year, of course, for universities, we did need to make a cut and find savings of £28.5 million. So when we were looking at this year's distribution, we modelled how that saving would fall across not only individual institutions, but across types of institutions. So we needed to take the 1,289 places out, we needed to take the pensions uplift out, and we needed to remove the upskilling fund and a couple of other pots that we needed to deal with in order to make those savings. But in every case, we look at the financial viability of an institution, we look at their ability to maintain their intake targets, and we look at the balance between the main teaching grant and the research and innovation funding, because in some cases they were getting an increase in research funding that mitigated some of the loss of the teaching grant. And we look at that in the round. We do lots of modelling and we test the impact on different institutions.
So you've said at the outset that it involves a review every year, and then you've also spoken about a number of different parameters, citing that it's fair and transparent across the centres. Earlier this morning we heard about how institutions are really looking for that budget stability and that certainty. And if you're modelling different things year on year, that is very counterintuitive to that stability that's there. And if it's different every year in how you're modelling, that's not particularly transparent for institutions. How can they have any idea what they're going to be judged on and even have a concept of what funding may be coming the next year if you're continually changing the goalposts?
So it's largely... So first of all, we do spend a lot of time discussing this with both the representative bodies and the individual institutions when the budget settlement is clear. So when we get the budget settlement, we engage over the next 2 or 3 months in negotiations and discussions about those options. So we do have stability in that we are keeping a certain amount of funded places in the system. So that is not a surprise. What was different this year was having to make the budget cut of £28.5 million. That was the significant issue that affected the distribution. But the starting point for every funding distribution is last year's. So it's not as though we are completely revisiting the funding model every time. We start from the premise that we are trying to keep stability, and we go from the footprint of what the university will have had in the previous year.
Perhaps we'll dig into this more as the thread goes on. Can I bring in Pam Duncan Glancy, please? Sorry, Pam, I'm getting a bit tongue-tied there. Carry on.
No problem at all, convener. It's the double barrel. It's annoying. Thank you very much for the questions you've answered so far. I want to ask a bit more about some of the allocation, and in particular to the post-92 universities as a starter. The committee's heard concern about cuts, which has fallen arguably disproportionately on those universities who also have quite a history in widening access. And you said a moment ago, Karen Watt, that widening access was one of the things that you were asked to protect.
Yes.
You've cut the student support budget and you've significantly cut funded places to those institutions. So can I ask how you consider the impact on those institutions?
So the student support funding is for colleges, not for universities. And when we looked at the university funding, we looked, and actually what's quite important, I think, in this is that some of the post-92s, not all, but some, were not filling their funded places.
Did you ask them why that was?
Yes, and I think the biggest issue for some will have been the drop in some colleges that were feeding their articulation into university. And also because we actually have a large number of funded places in the system. So what we are doing is we are obviously guardians of public money, so we need to make sure that we are investing in the right places, because otherwise that funding could go into other things. Mm. So where institutions have got unfilled places, that is public money that actually could be used in alternative ways. So we have removed a small portion of those underfilled places. In fact, we have taken probably no more than about a quarter of those unfilled places out of those institutions. We have left the rest, and institutions are looking at options for filling those over the course of their academic year, and they will have a number of intakes. And so we have left enough headroom for growth if they can manage their recruitment in that kind of way. And I would say, I don't actually think if we took that underfunded and underfilled places out, it is actually a fairly fair impact of those cuts across both post-92s, chartered institutions and the four ancients. We have looked and we modelled all of this, and actually we are not seeing a significant impact on the post-92s across the board when we take those unfilled place issue out.
Okay, I'm not sure that's the representation that we've had from those organisations, or indeed from University of Scotland, who said in advance that the SQA places that have been removed from the system in a different pattern to the way they were allocated in 2020-2021, meaning some institutions, the post-92s, were more negatively impacted than others. So what would your response be to that?
So we looked at two scenarios, when we were looking at the funding distribution, and in both, we were very clear with universities that we would take places out of institutions that were finding it difficult to fill them. In the first scenario, we had assumed we could take the 1,289 places out as they went in. But given that we were dealing with a second scenario, we needed to take those 1,300 or so places out from institutions that were not delivering their funded places. That's the choice that we made, and that is the choice that was late, and universities are quite right. We had a late policy articulation from government that they wanted no more than 1,289 places in total taken out of the system. Therefore, that's why the second model was developed.
And did you look at whether or not that would have an impact on widening access?
Yes, we did, and we have none of the cuts that we made have taken out the premiums, a lot of those widening access premiums, because we accept and we recognise that students from disadvantaged areas do require additional support to succeed. Those premiums have been protected. Those are largely being delivered through the post-92 universities. And taking these places out, as I say, it's a small proportion of their unfilled places. It does not affect their intakes, and it should not affect their widening access targets either.
Thank you. Have I time for one more?
At the moment, not really. Okay. You can maybe pick it up later in your other stuff. That's okay. Can I circle back to Bill Kidd now, please? Thank you.
Certainly. Thank you, convener. Ms Watt, you did mention earlier that the Scottish Funding Council has previously called for multi-year funding. Yes. Obviously, you haven't got that at the moment, but what further action do you believe that the Scottish Government can take now to enable the SFC to provide more support for institutions? I mean, you've talked about multi-year funding as one element. Is there anything else that...
There are probably a few bits in the recipe that would help. So it is undoubtedly true that multi-year funding settlements helps, because actually it allows institutions to plan over a long term rather than deal with short-term issues. We think that there is merit in transformation funding. We were disappointed when that transformation funding was no longer available, because that allows and enables institutions to adapt, whether it's looking at collaborations, different curriculum, that funding matters. We are very clear that research funding needs to be protected, and we are pleased that government is investing in that. There's been a 7% increase in research funding over the last few years, although of course you will have heard from others here today that it is the comparison with the other parts of the research system across the UK where monies have increased that is at play. There is something about, as I've said, the fragmentation of funding streams where government can look at things across the piece. I think it is very important that government thinks again about funds like the Flexible Workforce Development Fund, which were so very useful, particularly for colleges engaging with business and industry. It allowed them, it enabled them to have an infrastructure and a capacity within the college to actually then manage their relationship with employers to best effect. But and we would also like financial transactions to come back because they were low-cost loans. They helped us deliver quite a lot of net zero commitments, and they could potentially have been useful not just in universities but across the college sector as well. But I think the other aspect of this is actually to get on with some of the reform agenda. The government's been very clear they want to bring apprenticeship and funding provision together, which might deal with some of the issues of duplication. They have also talked about getting more involved in national and regional skills planning so that we are clear what kind of issues and skills might be required across Scotland and therefore how the university and college system can respond effectively to that. And those are issues which would be, I think, on the government's agenda already.
Okay, well, and on the back of that then, what level of urgency do you perceive from the Scottish Government in terms of support for further and higher education in Scotland just now?
So it is clear the government takes the situation seriously. They have protected, and we have been enabled to protect, frontline teaching in colleges. They have received a flat cash settlement, which of course is a real terms cut, but actually that ability to have flat cash settlements in the college sector over the last couple of years has been hugely important and understood. In our conversations, it is clear that the government is looking through the tripartite group and others at possible flexibility. So it is clearly an issue that they are giving considerable thought to.
Thank you. Do you want me to
carry on with your other themes? That's great, because okay. Michelle.
That's fine, thanks. Thank you for that response. Now, out with government and SFC money, what measures can colleges and universities look at to bring in additional revenue themselves?
So you will have heard from the first panel today that it is quite difficult for colleges to generate other income. About 7% of their income at the minute comes from other things like tuition courses or catering, some of those kind of things. But it is not huge. Some of the bigger colleges have some international contracts, but by and large, the reason it is challenging is because of the issues we've discussed before, how you keep those surpluses in play, what you can do with them. And it's also true to say that it is sometimes hard for colleges to price commercially sensitively when they have other competitors and who have lower fixed prices. I think what can we do? Well, I think they can use their arm's length foundations to put any additional commercial income into. We would like the government to reinstate programmes like the Flexible Workforce Development Fund, because that does enable colleges to generate the kind of other activity, because for colleges they effectively need to have the infrastructure and the economies of scale to allow them to develop these other income streams. We do see colleges being very smart about their engagement with employers, so getting employers to donate high-tech equipment and things like this, so we can see how they're working hard in those other ways. I think it is very different in the university sector, and therefore almost the funding model. They are much better placed to develop other income. And you will know that their reliance on our income is down to about 27-28% overall. So effectively, international activities, working with charities to generate research revenue, partnerships with industry and business, these are all happening. And of course, universities are getting and are very good at spin-outs, which of course are also incredibly important in terms of generating additional income.
Okay, well, that's very useful as well. But on the basis that colleges exist in order to provide education and life chances for people, for students, that's one thing that we always talk about. But in terms of the actual the buildings and so on, they can fall into disrepair. And funding for urgent maintenance can become important, and that demand, that demand for that has outstripped the funding that's available at the moment. So we're told. Can the SFC help colleges with this side of things?
So we have a budget of about £85 million in the round. £85 million for college capital. Now, a fair chunk of that goes into the new Dunfermline Learning Campus. So,
of that 85 million, so we know what's left for the rest.
52 million. Okay. So we have 30 million for capital maintenance in the round, and we have held back a certain amount, so about 2.5 million for very high priority ongoing issues or emergencies, things which arise. It is absolutely true that all colleges will receive less funding currently than they need to completely maintain and improve their estates. That is absolutely true. That being said, what we are doing is we're investing in the maintenance now with our £30 million and the £2.5 million of additional urgent monies that we have. But we're also in the middle of a very fundamental look at college infrastructure. And that will report by the end of this year with both a costed infrastructure plan, but also a more significant look and a baseline across the entire college sector, individual colleges and across the sector. We've brought in consultants to help work with that. It's not a traditional stocks survey because we're not trying to replace like by like. We're trying to look more fundamentally at infrastructure across the piece, digital as well as the estate and the fabric. And this baseline report will be the fundamental way of looking again at investment needs. So we're looking at the status of buildings, their suitability, what students might need and staff might need for the future. It's trying to future-proof, looking at digital infrastructure and how we expect buildings to be used over time. That is a very significant piece of work, and it will be fundamental to looking at the investment requirements of the sector going forward.
Very helpful. Thank you very much.
Oh, sorry.
Yes, please.
Just to flesh out some of that. I think one of the important things that we've done is we've combined our backlog and cyclical maintenance budgets so that colleges have more flexibility in how they use them. We've also said you can use that for capital digital investments. So we recognise that modern colleges also have significant investment needs in digital. So we're trying to free that up. I think we would always recognise that it is not enough, but we are trying to make it as flexible as possible. I think also it's worthwhile mentioning that we provide funding to support APUC and JISC, who provide efficiencies and economies of scale to the college sector. So APUC is the procurement vehicle, and JISC is about digital technology. And lastly, what we're trying to do is we're introducing what we call SCIM, so Scottish Capital Investment Manual, which will require colleges to bring forward outline plans so that we look earlier on about what they're proposing to do in their estate. One of the other things that we're doing in the college infrastructure strategy. There are 7 work packages there. One of them, as Karen mentioned, is about trying to get a kind of baseline of what the estate is just now, but get that in a digitalised fashion so that we can chop and dice it to look at what the requirements are across the whole of Scotland, less about what this college has and what it needs, and more about what does this area want and what does it need.
So it's being positive and addressing the issue ahead of time.
It's a major investment in our time and effort.
Okay. Well, and to be fair, I'm quite glad to see that. Looking at our report from 2023, in paragraph 384, we asked that the SFC do all it can to accelerate work to develop and implement its infrastructure investment plan, given our grave concerns regarding the significant level of backlog and life cycle maintenance required for the estate. So you spoke about there being about 30 million with a 2 million for really urgent things. Do you have any sense of the cost of the backlog and maintenance compared, because it will be far higher, I'm sure, than that 30 million with the 2 million for really urgent stuff?
We will be getting a much better picture through the work that we're conducting at the
moment. Any idea when, though, in terms of, because that was 2023, we've recommended that, and I'm sure each college is aware of its individual challenges, so I would have thought it would be, and I'm going to use these words carefully, relatively easy to pull all this information together from each of the various institutions
well, we
to give us
a
number.
That is a fundamental part of this, because while we have worked with the colleges to bring in experts to help look at this, that it will be about understanding what fresh data do colleges have. Can we rely on it? Can we support them in the way that they have got that information? So a lot of this work will depend exactly on that. What do colleges have and what can they share with us in all of this? We are aware and we work very closely with the state teams. So last year when we had a budget for emergency, very high maintenance, we did have a bidding process so that we could prioritise that for that very small amount of money. And we spent quite a lot of time with institutions working through, was that actually routine maintenance or could it be, was it actually urgent? But we will have a much better handle on all of this through this work that we're doing just
now. And that in itself sounds quite resource intensive on the institutions, which again incurs costs and pressures. Yes. So again, have we got any idea when we might see this report that lays bare the extent of the crisis that we have in our college estate in terms of the capital and the maintenance and what's going to be required? Because I think in our report we were linking it back to net zero targets and ambitions, and it's important. Our buildings across the public sector are a key contributor to this. So I'm framing it in that timeline and an area as well, if you could perhaps give us some indication.
So part of the premise behind the infrastructure strategy is to try and think about what the sector needs tomorrow, because it wouldn't be prudent use of public money to, if you like, refurbish buildings which are not going to be required next year. And there is the big challenge, because we could, I think, quite quickly go to the college estate and say, what do you require to make good? And RAC, of course, which I'm sure we'll come on to, has added to that burden. But the problem is many colleges are not going to be wanting that estate. We're talking to some colleges who have got really exciting and ambitious plans. And they have big problems with their estate at the moment, but their solution is not to repair them, but to go for a proposal to bring forward a new campus.
And perhaps that's something, in terms of the RAC, it might be something you can provide to us after the session, if we don't get the opportunity to delve into that in more detail. I'd like to pick up some questions just about the review of teacher funding that's recently been announced by the Scottish Government, and what information can you give us about that review, if that's possible at all, Karen Watt? Thanks.
Of course. So we have introduced quite a different and revised college funding model, and we are continuing to evolve that. So when we're talking about a review, it is building on the funding model that the new funding model that we introduced, which lowered credit thresholds, it looked at the buffer and tolerance around under and over delivery. It rebased the price per credit, so the credit is the currency we use for one credit is about 40 hours of learning. And what we are doing in the looking at our review is probably about three or four elements. The first is looking at, can our funding model take more account of changing demographics and demand? So at the minute, when it's basically checking that our credits and our distribution are being allocated in the right place. So looking and modelling where are senior phase students coming from, what are school leaver projections, what are the population trends looking like between the 15 and 19-year-old population and school leavers, what are regional skills assessment telling us, and where do we believe that some colleges are have more demand and can we shift our credits around? Now, the issue with all of that is in a fixed pot, you have to find it from somewhere. So when we look at this review, it's really a more evidence-based look at where changing demographics and demand patterns are leading us to think differently about funding. The second element is really pulling out some of the components. So, for example, we have a mix of subject prices, and we are looking again at whether we've got the right price for those subject mixes, and also the way we pay premiums. So we pay premiums to the college sector for widening access, remoteness in rural areas where we know provision is more expensive, but we need it to be there. So we pay premiums for all of this, and we need to make sure that those are both fair because they've been embedded in the model for quite some time. And I think the third element is looking at what should our tertiary education budget be spent on. And this is a huge conversation, not just with colleges, but with the government as well, because we are currently paying and using our investment into senior phase activities, for example. Now, that's hugely important because it brings a thread of students through from school into college. But I suppose it's just asking some basic questions. We fund half of all foundation apprenticeships in the senior phase. And again, I guess reviews like the James Withers review suggested that that could be looked at again in terms of, is that right for a tertiary education to be funding that? And so we will be working with government on that. And the fourth element is really the review of apprenticeships and apprenticeship funding, which the government is leading, but which may have implications for how we look at our reform. So those are some of the elements of the college funding model that we're looking at. And we are just in the process of working through how best to organise that review so that we can take all stakeholders with us over the next few months.
Okay. In terms of the apprenticeship review, you know, we've spoken at length as a committee about the importance of that. Is there anything further you can give on that at this stage, or is it still far too early?
Well, the government has said that they have three big areas of reform that they're looking at. One is bringing funding provision together, including apprenticeships. And I understand that there are some working groups that are starting, both looking at graduate, modern and foundation apprenticeships. And clearly we will be involved in all of those, but the government is leading them at this time.
Okay, thank you. I know you were in listening to the first panel, and we did have a lengthy discussion around the international student income being almost cross-subsidising, perhaps some might say, the home fee students. And I was wondering what your thoughts were on that and how the 2025-26 budget might begin to address that issue that is clearly so embedded now within the Scottish institutions.
Yes, the sector does rely very heavily on international income, undoubtedly, and it does cross-subsidise teaching and research activity. I have to say, I think that is a hugely common business model across most universities across the world. This is not unusual to Scotland, and certainly the issues that are we're seeing in Scotland are rippling right across the UK, and all universities are looking at this in particular. And Scotland is still a hugely attractive destination, largely because students receive a hugely important high quality education. And it is important to say, because this is sometimes part of the discourse, that international students don't displace Scottish domestic students. The funded places are there for Scottish students. But actually what does happen is that some courses run only because international students are there. So it hugely benefits domestic students, and it does enrich not only all of our lives, but a student experience as well. I think from a funder's perspective, we are seeing a big downturn in international income, and that's clearly a risk. So we're seeing, and our mid-year review estimates are the most up-to-date information that anyone will have at this time, and we're seeing a reduction of around £40 million from last year in terms of international student income. And the biggest decline is really in postgrad students. So undergrad international student demand is holding up fairly well. The issue for us is, for us as a funder, we're looking at the concentrations. So there are about five countries, international countries, where over half of the international students come to Scotland from. So China, India, the USA, Nigeria, Pakistan. And therefore, what changes happen in those countries, or what competition happens, particularly in Australia and Canada, massively affects the flow of international students to Scotland. I think it is also fair to say there are huge variations across the university sector in Scotland. So, you know, almost well over 40% of international students are studying at Edinburgh and Glasgow. So, this is it's both concentrated and a different kind of issue across the sector. One of the things that I think we're keeping a very weather eye on is that it's not that we are unbothered by cross-subsidisation. We are clear about the benefits and the risks that come from volatile international markets, and we've seen that it can drop very, very quickly. Universities are hugely adaptable. But when we talk about, for example, the post-92s, the issues that it's the accumulation of issues. It's the fact that we are seeing potentially a drop in domestic demand. We are seeing some of the post-92s operating in more volatile international markets. Therefore, they are more exposed. And they all deal with this really well, but it is a challenge. And you will have heard in the first panel an interest in transnational education. So Scottish educators either having campuses or arrangements overseas with other partner organisations. That does take time. It is also a lot of investment up front. It can offer a huge amount of opportunity, and we're seeing more interest in that, which I think will be something we'll be tracking over time. And the other factor I would just put on the committee's radar is that quality and quality assurance really matters. So we have taken a decision with the Scottish Government that we will keep maintaining European quality benchmarks and independent cyclical reviews. That matters because other governments look at not just league tables, they look at quality assurance. So by maintaining these European quality benchmarks, we will have the right environment for Scottish universities to continue to attract Scottish students and to potentially work further overseas.
Okay, thank you. We've also heard over the last few weeks, and it's been widely covered in the press, about some courses being cut based on financial considerations alone. And I think I was thinking the one that came to mind was the languages up in the northeast. So does the SFC recognise these concerns, and what support can be offered to the institutions that are finding themselves in these situations?
Yes, I mean, we have we've got a couple of pathfinders that are looking at curriculum development at the minute, and one of those is actually in the northeast, and we're looking at collaboration, how institutions plan for their curriculum. And clearly what we're finding is institutions change their curriculum on a pretty regular basis. So they're always looking at demand, they're looking at employer needs, they're looking at where students are thriving, and they part of the quality process is that they look at this on a regular basis. I think it's always difficult when an institution cuts provision, and languages is a particularly difficult one, partly because we think it is hugely important that there is a range of subjects and there's choice for Scottish students, and there is choice not only across Scottish universities but in institutions that they can attend locally. But it is also very difficult if students are coming out of school and fewer students are coming out of school with language skills, and therefore it is, I think, inevitable that some of these courses will be reviewed in particular ways. So I think it is for institutions themselves to think very carefully about the provision, the choice, the nature of the provision that they're making. We know that institutions, particularly in the Northeast, are looking at their provision. Not all institutions are cutting courses. Some are amalgamating joint honours or looking at their curriculum in particular ways. It is something we are tracking. We are not seeing particular problems across the course provision at the minute. There is still choice, but we are tracking it. So it is something we're acutely aware of as funding changes over the next few years. We will want to be keeping a very weather eye on that.
That's helpful. Thank you. Can I now come to Ross Greer, please? Thank you, Ross.
Thanks. Good morning. Karen, you'll have seen the questions I was asking in the earlier session, which is similar to what I've been asking panelists last week. I'm interested in particular on colleges, what the SFC's role is in ensuring that colleges are obliging or are following up on their fair work conditions. Correct me if I'm wrong in the first instance, the primary way through which the SFC would be involved in this is in terms of the college outcome agreements. If there's commitments to fair work made in the outcome agreement, the SFC would have a role then in checking that those have been fulfilled. Can you outline a little bit how that works in practice?
Yes. So in terms of Fair Work, our role is threefold. We promote good practice. So it is not only in our outcome agreements, all of which are published, so all of them will have information about Fair Work in them. It's a condition of grant. And increasingly, for reasons that I might touch on, we have now strengthened the accounts directions for colleges and universities for this year. Second issue is we are requiring better reporting from institutions. We have found the information we received from the outcome agreements, which we did an internal assessment of, very variable. As a result of that, we have strengthened and changed the accounts direction so that statements and information, we've also set out more clearly the issues that we would like auditors to be more carefully scrutinising. We expect that to come through for this year. We are also going to be talking to Audit Scotland about our expectations that auditors will consider these Fair Work statements and will provide a more thorough look at this, because we have found, I would say, a variety of responses to through our outcome agreement process. I think the third area I would just touch on briefly is where there are particular issues in particular situations, we may well need to get more involved, either to explore what is going on. And of course, Fair Work intersects with a lot of other issues in industrial relations and guidance on things like severance and redundancy. So quite often Fair Work issues can become part of those discussions. And we need to be very careful that we are not stepping into legitimate business in terms of the running of a college. But we do have a responsibility to promote and to make sure Fair Work is in place, and therefore we will become involved if we see issues emerging or where we are seeing patterns and particular hotspots that may require a further further scrutiny from us.
Thanks very much. That's really useful. I'd like to come back to that point of what it looks like in practice if there is a problem and you do need to get involved. Yeah. But just in the first instance, when the outcome agreement is being drafted, on Fair Work specifically, is it an individual bespoke approach that each college is allowed to take with quite a lot of flexibility, or do you approach them all with a kind of minimum set of standards based on Scottish Government Fair Work policy? What's the baseline criteria that you would say actually you simply cannot have a Fair Work agreement that does not meet at least X, Y, and Z?
We expect the government's Fair Work policy to be the bedrock, and we expect Fair Work criteria that are well established, including criteria that have extended recently from the Scottish Government, to be the bedrock standards that apply. It is for institutions to make sure that they are conducting themselves in line with those criteria. And when I said we were having variable reports, it was more on the reporting aspect of how they were describing that and managing the information back to us on how well they were complying with some of these Fair Work criteria, which is why we strengthened other channels, because we were simply not seeing that reporting coming back to us in the way that we did. Now, it's early days. This is the second year that we've been doing this, so we simply need it to be better.
Is your ability to take action if a point of Fair Work conditionality is not met, is that confined purely to what is in existing Scottish Government Fair Work policy, or would you still be able to take action if a college had actually came to you perhaps on the basis of a local agreement with their trade unions and said, this is one of our this is one of our Fair Work policies, we want this to be part of our outcome agreement, and they are then, for whatever reason, unable to or do not meet that. Would you have any role there, or is your role in ensuring Fair Work conditionality is being delivered confined to existing Scottish Government Fair Work policy?
I feel you may have a case in mind here, but I think in general we take the Scottish Government's general Fair Work criteria as our main approach. It is absolutely right that there is an effective employer voice and effective industrial relations, so we would expect local agreements to happen where that is appropriate, but I don't think it is the funding council's role necessarily to mediate those local bespoke arrangements. But we would be concerned if the very fundamental principles of Fair Work were being breached in particular ways.
What options are available to you? Is it simply a case of calling back money that the Fair Work Agreement money that was provided conditioned on the Fair Work Agreement being met, or are there other mechanisms available to you?
So it is always extremely difficult for a funder to put financial penalties into a college where it might affect students and frontline service delivery, and that is the conundrum for a funder, what penalties to actually put in place. We are extremely reluctant to put that kind of funding clawback as a penalty. That being said, when we publish information, it has a very, let's just say it does have results, because we can publish material that ensures that colleges improve and that do things differently. And that is actually quite a powerful mechanism. I would say if we were looking to the future and what a funding body might be, whether the government reforms SSC or looks at it more generally, I think the levers and the powers that a funding body might have in future around these kind of slightly broader issues, fundamental issues, but broader issues, might be something that is worth looking at. Our powers lie in an act that is 2005. And actually, while we have upgraded and kept in step with all of these policies, I think there is a role for government to look at the powers that a funding body or a successor to SSC if that happens, what powers might be most useful in these kind of circumstances. And we have actually proposed a range of other alternatives that we might want to see over time, which would strengthen our ability to not just have the extreme powers of recovering money or triggering a statutory investigation, but powers in between, which actually could be quite helpful. The other, just very briefly, the other aspect of this is when we see other organisations, we rely on other organisations a lot, Education Scotland, QAA for quality, the financial auditors for financial scrutiny of bodies that we fund. Again, they will have other aspects of their powers that we can use as well, whether it's the charities regulator, OSCAR, or whether we have auditors through Audit Scotland making comments, particularly in this kind of area in the future.
Thanks very much. Very, very useful. And forgive me, this is something that I think I should know, but the set of proposals that you just mentioned that you've made for what future funding body or a reformed SFC might have, is that in the public domain or have you submitted that directly
to
government?
We haven't put that in the public domain because the government asked us for our views specifically on if there was a reform agenda around the landscape, because as you know, there are proposals that Withers and others have put forward about duplication in the funding landscape and having funding brought together. So we have obviously put forward a proposition which is that the SFC is the foundational body but could be reformed in terms of its powers, and we have suggested what some of those powers might look like. The last thing I think Scotland needs at the minute is another standalone regulator, but I do think that a funding council with slightly different levers and slightly different powers of intervention could be extremely powerful.
Thank you. Can I come now to Pam Duncan-Glancy, please? Thank you, Pam.
Thank you, convener. I find that exchange really helpful. Thank you. And some of my questions have already been answered. The one question I just wanted to put now then is, what can I ask what your expectations are of colleges when it comes to voluntary severance?
Yes, so we have put our guidance out on voluntary severance. Actually, I should say up front that we are reviewing our guidance on this at this present time, and we'll have new guidance developed, because at the minute most of our severance guidance deals with value for money and aspects of following rules around conditions of payment, and it has to be in line with the SPFM, the Scottish Public Finance Manual, and we work within that context. So we are reviewing the guidance at this point in time because we expect colleges not just to be looking at value for money, but to be looking at the kind of broader issues that we've been talking about this morning. So impact on staff, impact on curriculum, impact on students and their choice. And we are broadening our guidance formally to require different and further information from colleges about how voluntary severance schemes work and their consent by us to those schemes.
Thank you. The Minister said that it includes requirements, the outcome agreement includes requirements for colleges to, and I'm going to quote, approvals for voluntary severance schemes, to get approvals from yourselves.
Yes,
is that the case?
That is right. Yes.
And have all colleges that have done this sought that approval?
Most will come to us, yes, and we are not aware of any at the minute that have not. We are aware of all of the voluntary severance schemes that are in a place at the minute across Scotland's colleges, yes.
Okay, thank you. Liam Kerr now, please. Thanks.
Yes, I'm very grateful. The SFC had to make some very difficult choices following the last budget to save £28.5 million from the university resource budget. Now, one of those choices was to remove the contribution of, I think, several million pounds to the employer's contribution of the Scottish Teachers Superannuation Scheme. My understanding is that such a decision has a much greater impact on Scotland's modern universities, given the rules on the STSS pension scheme and the enrolment. Now, I know that this has been raised both with the government and the SFC, but just for the record, what can the government and or the SFC do to mitigate, to ameliorate, or even perhaps in future to reverse this hit to modern universities' resource budgets?
So very specifically, the contribution that we made was 4.8 million. And we had signalled a couple of years ago that that was a contribution that we wouldn't be making into the long term. So we, the last contribution was due to be in academic year 22-23. And we were able to find money for a further year. So actually, we had already signalled that we would not be paying this contribution for the long term. Our funding couldn't maintain that contribution. So it is, excuse me, it should not be a surprise to the university sector, and they should have been planning with that in mind. That being said, completely understand the difficulty, particularly when the pensions have, you know, they go up and down, and there has been a rise in this. So we're acutely aware of that. It is worth noting that other pension schemes have gone up more in more difficult ways, and that we have not made any contribution to that, and neither does any other funding body across the UK make a contribution to those funding contributions. So this was a very helpful amount of money, but actually we had already signalled it was going to stop. I think the biggest issue for us is taking a step back and looking at the funding across the piece. So we were very careful in the post-92s to maintain other premiums that are not available to other institutions, like the Widening Access and Retention Fund, which has a very significant impact on supporting widening access students. We also, and this is a difficult comparison to make, but when we were looking at savings, we were trying to balance that. So, for example, we phased out some of the compensation we make for strategically expensive subjects. That fell more squarely on the older institutions. So in all of this, we've been trying to balance where those cuts fell, where we had already signalled that we were making a change, and difficult though this might be, we will keep an eye on it, but I think it will depend very much on the overall funding envelope that we get for 25-26 and beyond. I would say at this point it's unlikely that that will come back into play, but it is something we will keep a very strong eye on.
Understand.
Thank you very much. And I'd like to thank the panel for your time this afternoon now. And the public part of today's meeting is now at an end. We'll consider our final agenda item in private, so I now suspend the meeting. Thank you very much.